For me, space is started as a fascination as a child. The day I understood that space was not an abstraction, but that was reality. As you grow up, your mind expands, and the world goes from being the size of your family to filling your streets, and then the world is your city, and maybe the world is your province or your country, your continent. And eventually you realize, wow, the world is the whole planet. And then you realize it doesn't stop there. That's just a tiny piece of the universe. And so as a child, when I realized what those images meant, the little blue planet floating in the black velvet of space, that this was not an abstraction, this is reality. You are here, that arrow there, you are here, this is reality. For me, this started a long process of wanting to understand everything about everything, and a fascination for that perspective of space. I didn't think that being an astronaut was possible. It wasn't really an option anyway. When I was a kid, there were no Canadian astronauts when I was a child. But I allowed myself to model myself on astronauts. I thought, like some people like to model themselves on medieval knights or samurais. Even though you can't be one of those things, it's okay. You can still use that as a model, right? So same with me. I thought I would model myself on what I thought astronauts were as a child. So for me, that meant I got to continue going to school. I got to become a scientist. I got to become an explorer. I got to become a trustworthy adult who can accomplish missions. And I got to be a curious person. I got to speak languages. And all of that led me to a life of kind of fun discovery of as much as I could about the world around me. And much later, when I was working as a physician up in the Arctic, I heard they were recruiting astronauts, and I realized quickly that I had the basic requirements to apply, and it's as if I heard the voice of a little boy in the back of my mind, in the back of my head. This little five-year-old boy said, "Oh, please try. You gotta try. At least try. Give it a shot." This is an amazing opportunity to accomplish a childhood dream. My duties as a co-pilot of the Soyuz rocket that will bring us to the space station means I have to basically get my Soyuz license. And that's a lot of time spent first in classroom, all in Russian, learning about the systems and every little detail of the quirks of the command control system and all of that, and their emergency response. And then we got into the second half, which was very practical. So the very high fidelity simulators of the Soyuz capsule, where every button works, and we go through every phase of the space flight, ascent and orbit and re-entry. And here you are, the three of us in the capsule, and in a room somewhere are the instructors, and they're making things break. They're breaking the computer on us. They're breaking the engines on us. They're breaking the oxygen system on us. They're starting a fire for us. They're doing a leak on us. They just keep throwing these problems at us. And initially, we're a bit goofy, we don't know how to react, but over time, we get better and better and better. And at the end, when they see that you can respond correctly to everything they can throw at you, then they give you a certification and you're good to go. Launch day is a very long day because you wake up, you get ready, you wrap up your suitcase if you want, and then you gotta completely disinfect yourself, and then you gotta put on your spacesuit, which is a lengthy process, and then we do a very thorough check of the suit, of its pressure integrity, a leak check we call. Once you've done all that, which is several hours already into your day, then you can start to think about going near the rocket. Then there's a couple hours just to settle in and check all the systems. So by the time the launch happens, it's already been a 10 hours day. Then you go to space, that takes about 8 minutes, and you're in orbit. And then you still have 6 hours to make it to the space station. So it's a long day altogether. It's a very, very long day. And it ends with the most critical operation, the docking, which is, you can imagine, these two spacecrafts are going at 8 kilometers per second. And you gotta soup very, very precisely within a couple of centimeters and a couple of centimeters per second dock the Soyuz to one of the docking ports of the space station. And then so this very crucial, dangerous operation takes place at the end of a very, very long day. So I think it's a day where you want to make sure you're fresh and you have slept well and you're focused, because there's a lot at stake.
And there's our backup crew. I know you mentioned they do this kind of in preparation for their own launch.
Having the opportunity to see a launch as a member of the backup crew is very useful, and kind of takes away 95% of the novelty aspect of it. At least you know the lay of the land, you know what's going to happen practically. But I had a few moments, like when I saw the rocket coming from the assembly factory to the launch pad, suddenly I had a sense of the spacecraft inside the fairing, that little capsule, the seat there, all the panels. Oh, this little simulator environment that I've spent so many hours in, it's up there. This is where it is. In reality, it's in that capsule in the nose cone there, buried in there. And this is where I'm going to be. And it hit home that this is not a joke. This is more than training. At the end of it, it's a real space flight. When you're in orbit with a crew of five or six, you know, you're kind of on your own for medical problems, right? Someone had a cut, a burn, a shock, or whatever, an infection. You got to take care of it yourself. So we're prepared for that. At some point, you're kind of on your own if the problem becomes too big, and you will need help. You want help. So that's called telemedicine. And the art of providing telemedical help or enhancing autonomy for the crew is, you know, it's a big topic in space exploration, because as we go further than space station, one day go to Mars, for example, we will need a lot of autonomy. Now, what's interesting, especially for a country like Canada, is that that problem of autonomy for the crews and telemedicine, if needed, is the same problem you face if you're a nurse in a little community up in the Arctic, for example. Or if you're an elderly person who's bedbound, you know, or homebound, and it's difficult to go to the hospital, or maybe an expedition in a faraway place on Earth on a ship or something. So these problems of remote healthcare, they're exactly the same problems as we have on orbit. And there's great cross-pollination, if you want, in that area. So a lot of the experiments we do on board space station, they belong to those categories. But specifically for Canada, it's mostly the medical stuff and the healthcare related. For me personally, having been a first-line, you know, family doctor in a small community in the Arctic, anything that we can do to enhance medical autonomy of people who are in remote areas really touches me, because I know I could have used this. And I know I have colleagues who could use it tomorrow morning. And so for me, this is not pie in the sky space research. This is totally, all of it is totally applicable here on Earth. Space exploration for a developed nation like Canada is absolutely fundamental to our lifestyle. We use space every day, just like we use the post office and we use our highways. It's part of our national infrastructure. Not a day goes by without us using satellites, images from space, the weather forecast, telecommunication. Our national defense is run from space. Even agriculture, the food we eat, is kind of managed from space. So space is part of the fabric of our society, and it's space is also how we're going to protect our planet, how we're going to monitor beautiful planet Earth, and how we're going to take care of her as, you know, responsible species, responsible tenants, if you want, of the planet. So for Canada, space is a very worthy endeavor for those reasons. Space is also one of those few arenas where humans work together well, where we kind of rise above the fray and the tensions that are real, these real political tensions that are everywhere. Still, somehow in space, we don't bring these conflicts with us in space. We work together very well in space, and I've been doing so for several decades, even through the depth of the Cold War.
If you turn on the camera, hit the remote, okay. Here.
Camera. So personally, that's very important. I think for a country like Canada, who traditionally likes to have a role of mediation and of kind of reasonable understanding among people, It's kind of a very space-like type of mentality that we can work together, and if we work together, we'll accomplish amazing things.